Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage our conference co-chairs, Michael Reed and Allison Spirity.
Here, here, I did with that. And also, I just want to say, on a personal level, this two-year odyssey with Allison, thank you, where I got, has been amazing. And it just reminded me just how brilliant our membership is. Those committees, all those discussions about what we should do, what would be controversial, what wouldn't, all the discussions, amazing membership, and it humbled me. And it made me feel even closer to this community. This is a big family now, to me even more so. So thank every one of you in the room who are a part of that. You're an amazing membership.
We'd also like to thank the magnificent Scott Stoner from APAP, who really puts all of this together. And and that being said, we would like to invite our fearless leader, Mario Garcia Durham, to the stage. Thank you all so much.
Great. Good morning, everyone. I just heard the most fantastic bit of news that I wanted to share from our dear friend Michael Orloff. It appears that, fingers crossed, the Congress is going to be giving the National Endowment, which was under threat of a severely, severely limited allocation. And apparently they're going to, looks like, fingers crossed, come through with $146 million, which is fantastic. Good news for our start of our day. So just again, a huge thank you to Allison and Michael. I don't know, those of you that have been chairs of conferences know how much work and dedication it takes. So again, in the spirit of acknowledgement to Allison and Michael, please, huge round of applause. So at this time, I'd like to do something that's very important to me, and I would imagine important to you as well, and that is actually acknowledging the great APAP staff and team that puts all of this together. I'm going to call out a list of names, and then I'm going to ask them to stand en masse, so please hold your applause as we go through. Gil Gonzalez, Judy Moore, Megan Redmond, Mallory Keith, Sue Noseworthy, Mia DiStefano, Scott Stoner, Laura Benson, Kaylin Saylor, Jenny Thomas, Emily Travis, Melinda Lambert, Nicola Turner, Rebecca Celesta, Margaret Stevens, John Spencer, Alicia Anstead, Phil Seaman, and many, many more. I also want to thank Craig's team, and I would like all of you to please stand up. Fiona Shaw is a living legend. I don't think there's anyone in the room who has not heard of Fiona or experienced her work. She has been very active here in the States recently, and has done amazing work for all of us, especially American audiences. She has been awarded countless honors, including the Laurence Olivier Theater Award, the London Critics Circle Theater Awards, and was nominated for Broadway's 2003 Tony Award in Medea. And she is also a commander of the Order of the British Empire. She's also done many, many film roles, including The Black Dahlia and True Blood. But she's also done, I believe, 5 Harry Potter movies. And I'm a fan. And my favorite character in the movies, or one of them, is the horrid and wicked Petunia Dursley, who is Harry's aunt. And I think she does a wonderful, brilliant role, as all great actresses do, in just making her wicked. So I want to thank you for that. And then finally, I went onto the internet and I found 2 quotes attributed to her. And since it was on the internet, I'm sure it's true. And the first is, "I certainly had no intention of playing a man." I love that. For some bizarre reason, I love that. And then secondly, "I am not afraid of chaos and I'm happy talking to strangers. I really love not knowing where I'm going." I think that is brilliant. So at this point, ladies and gentlemen, please, please welcome our very, very special guest, Fiona Shaw.
Specifically in the audience will know who I mean, people who've bounced us into BAM via Washington. I mean, we're really helped by this inventiveness of what you do. Now, last night I was having dinner, and we were discussing your conference and talking about what is it that runs the American theater, or what is it that can run any, I hope, international theater, because I want us and you to meet more, is, you know, it cannot be finance that runs the idea that has underpinned the potential shining idea, because you never know when something is going to shine. And you don't know whether it will shine at the time or shine later. It's no good for the theater financier to discover it shone later. But it has been remarkably, in my experience, that it does shine later. And that's partially because I've walked into some phenomenal disasters. So I thought I might just talk a little bit about how things shine out of the darkness, but they often come from the darkness. In 1993 or so, Deborah Warner and I were given a present of a West End theater for a few weeks. It was free, and they said you could just have it. You could put anything you like on in it. So we got our great friend John Cannon, and we decided to do a production of Beckett's play, Footfalls, which is quite a short play, some of you will know. And it's about a character called Amy, or May, and she either is alive or she isn't. And she has a mother or she doesn't. We had reached that moment, I think, in modern drama, where theatre had ceased to exist really on the stage, which is what Beckett's done. It exists in the pauses that the audience fill in their own minds. I mean, there are wonderful speeches in it. I'll just quote one which goes like this. A little later, when she was quite forgotten, she began to... A little later, when as though she had never been, it never been, she began to walk at nightfall, slip out at nightfall into the little church, always locked at that hour, and walk up and down his poor arm. Sometimes she would stand still, like one startled by the mind. She goes on at this, these pauses occur. And in the pause, the audience panic. They go, oh my God, that actress has forgotten her lines. Well, I really want to get my washing done. I've got to get that from the dry cleaner. And somewhere, I think that is what Beckett wants, is he says, God is dead. Now we just have this void, and theatre isn't going to supply the truth any more than God did. The sound in your head is where eternity goes on ricocheting. Anyway, we produced this play, and instead of performing it on the stage, as is prescribed very strictly by Beckett, I performed it on the front row of the balcony, you know, just up there, because she was a ghost, she existed or didn't exist. And if a ghost appeared in the theatre, where would she appear? So I stood up and down, I walked up and down, 7 steps up and down the balcony, and my mother, who was performed by Susie Engel, was in a box, hidden, because she did or didn't exist. And I wore a red dress, though Beckett does prescribe that she wears a grey tattered dress. But our designer was German, and she said, the seating is red plush, and if you wear red against red, that's grey. Okay. So I walked up and down, she goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 wheel. It's a very depressing thing. And I performed it, the audience came in, they suddenly heard someone speak, they looked up there I was, the balcony had turned around. Then at the end of the sequence of this play, I would come down the back of the stairs and come down onto the stage for the last sequence, which is a little story that May tells. Well, the Beckett estate went insane. And they banned it immediately, and it was closed down. And on the, it had an injunction, which is an amazing thing. Also had front page newspapers, of course, which was very exciting. It said, Fiona Shaw, Deborah Warner will never do Beckett again, says Beckett Estate. Front page, God. Meanwhile, the French producers had given us 25,000 euros to produce this event. It was going to go to Paris as well. And I say this because it's only the Parisians. It was closed down, everybody's crying. My mother booked a flight, she was coming, you know, everything gone. The two things happened. The 2 days before it closed, it had to close on the Saturday, it was on Thursday and Friday. Every limousine in England turned up with chihuahuas. Everybody turned up. It was suddenly an overnight sensation. That was one marvelous thing. And the producers, you know, impoverished though they were able to smile. Pop stars, everybody, the aristocracy, who didn't have much really, they were all there. And then on Sunday, when we were closed down and there was a sort of, you know, yellow daubed paint all over the audience, Claire Bertrand, who was our producer, she said, very philosophically, as only the French can, no, it's very good it has been closed down, because sometimes a vacuum is more important than a presence. No wonder France is in the mess it's in. Anyway, that was one such thing. The other thing is, you don't, I mean, there are other strange things. The other thing is, you don't know why something will turn into something that will shine. Another one I did was, we did Medea, which came to Broadway. And, thank you. But that's, I was a younger woman then, I can tell you. And I didn't want to do Medea. In fact, I was being asked to play Hamlet because I had played Richard II. So I'm going to digress from Richard II. I was asked to play Richard II at the National Theatre, where still the National Theatre at that time, despite being maybe the most important merchant bank of culture in England, still allowed itself to be a place of experiment. And it was an experiment that I should play Richard II when the corridors of the National Theatre were crawling with actors who were dying to play Richard II. My popularity among my main male colleagues was, you know, zero. Anyway, I was chosen to play Richard II, and the rest of the cast were men as they are in the parts. It was just this one woman in the middle of it. And it was a very difficult thing to put on. And it was, as somebody described recently in Dublin, they said, when it came on, the critics looked like chickens who had just seen a fox. Horrified, because they thought that I was ruining the history of England, because I thought I could have joined the IRA, it would have been easier. I didn't say that. what became evident in this maelstrom of upset was that somewhere those plays, those Shakespeare plays, had become the sort of, they had become the anthems of British history. They weren't really plays, they were prayers about England. Old John of Gaunt, Time on Lancaster, Hathor, according to that, Oath of Man, Bought Hither, Henry Hereford. Then came a sort of single phrase that said something about the English people's view of themselves. And therefore, I think against everyone's expectations, had become ossified into something as dull as the Our Father. They just sat there as prayers. So I performed Richard II and got absolutely hammered for it in England. It won many prizes abroad, notably in France. Where not only had they the philosophique, but they also had understood that they liked what they did with kings who behaved badly, as they chopped their heads off. And they didn't reinstate them, they created a republic, which is probably a wise thing. So they thought it was very funny that Richard II behaved very badly. But there was some of the letters subsequently, Richard Eyre was our head honcho at the National at the time, he got a lot of letters of objection against my playing Richard II. But one of his most amusing ones was that people got very confused watching it, not knowing what was wrong, why was this female person playing Richard? In fact, Richard II does not think of himself as a man, he sort of thinks of himself as a god. So in a way, he's sort of genderless. He also has very little to do with women in the play. So it never really arises, so to speak. You just have to be this god who turns into a human. That's really what the play is about. And that's why I thought it was at all possible. And very often, very macho men wasted a lot of energy trying to be feminine whilst playing Richard II. And in fact, at least with a woman, you don't have to worry about that. You just think, well, I'll just play it. And one of the letters of objection from somebody was, we noticed that Richard II at his court had some African servants. This was true. There was a wonderful actor called Jude Apodiki. He's a gorgeous man, and he played my maid servant, and he wore a skirt, a sort of, you know, medieval skirt. And there was another guy as well who was less important than Jude. And they both were my assistants, and they wore skirts, and I wore a sort of, I was bandaged up like a mummy, because they, you know, to get rid of my shape. But whenever I wore trousers, I looked like a woman in trousers, and that didn't work at all. So we had to get, I was like a mummy with the skirt. So the three of us wore skirts. And this person put in and said, you know, it's really very unfair to come place like this. It really is very irrelevant to our culture, because there were no African assistants to the king in 1280. And this person forgot to write, and by the way, the woman named Richard II was a woman, not a man. So people didn't know what was wrong. And all I can say is the really good benefit of that is that I found it very uncomfortable. I didn't like the maelstrom, I didn't like the fuss, I didn't like the hostility, I didn't like the people throwing I didn't like the lampooning, I didn't like any of it. But 10 years later, I would say it was the thing that I was most proud of having done. And I would say that to the producers here, and indeed to all of the presenters, is that very often, the thing you do at the time, if it is the right thing, and does bring down the house around it, 10 years later, you'll be very proud you've done it. And I think the future of the theater must be urged forward in this way. It's an unfortunate art form because it happens in the moment. And the success of it is whether the thing communicates. But is that true? I think it ricochets for years after the event. And I would say wherever I go, it's maybe Electra, Richard II, or Medea, these sort of strangely surprising events were the things for which we became most known. Not necessarily doing, you know, my great Shakespeare heroines that I so enjoyed doing. And because of these experiments in the theatre causing such a stir, Deborah and I tried to see whether there was another way of making the theatre that wouldn't make people so cross. So we thought, well, we won't do plays at all, we'll just do something else. And we won't do them in the theatre, we'll do them somewhere else. So we tried to invent a way of having a non-play in a non-theatre space. And I have been invited to do The Wasteland in Germany at the Schauburg with German actors. And so at the same time, Deborah was asked to do something with architecture in Brussels. She said, do you know any good poems? I said, as it happens, I do. I said, I've just learned The Wasteland, have you learned it? I said, I have. So she said, well, let's give it a go. So we went around Brussels experimenting with this we're making theatre out of a non-theatre text. And so I was sometimes lying at the bottom of a well of a staircase, going, April is the cruelest month, reading dialect. She'd go, no, that won't work. So and there was also no rehearsal room. We weren't given any rehearsal room. So we were given a house in which to rehearse. That, you know, in Brussels, everything's for sale or up for rent. And you see signs everywhere. A louer avant. So we were given a house, a louer. And we were in this house. And I didn't really understand the poem, but I began to invent the poem in the house. So April is the cruelest month. I remember well, standing by a fireplace in this empty house, going, April is the cruelest month. And it began to remind me of my friend at school, Sue Fernie's mother, who used to have a pug dog and a glass of gin and tonic and a cigarette. And she was really very dexterous. She was that. Somehow, Hazel Fernie was her name. Hazel was in my mind. So I began to think, well, the first line is, April is the cruelest month. Reading lilacs out of the dead land. She was very good at gardening. And you know there's a line, the line coming up which says, and goes south in the winter. And I had worked the year before with Herbert Ross, who's since died, who's a marvelous, marvelous man. And I could see him saying, I'm going south in the winter. So I began to find fragments of my own life, fragments of people I'd heard quoting certain lines in the poem. And so, in this house, I began to invent a way in which every line had a root in my life. So too, but nobody would know that, the audience would know that, but at least Deborah and I would know it, and we'd have a way of fixing the units whenever they were wrong. And there's including, you know, there's these strange girls in it who go, Wayala, Wayala, La Leia, Waleya, Waleya, which is taken from the Ring Cycle. Well, obviously, you know, who would know the Ring Cycle necessarily and know it was the Rhyme Maidens? But my mother used to always randomly sing snatches when she was burning herself baking anything in the kitchen. She'd go, so the Rhyme Maidens became my mother. I could never study as a student because I would hear the following. My mother would just go, she'd sit down at the piano after dinner and she'd go, oh, the days of the carry dancing, oh, the telephone, hello. Hello. Oh, nobody. So she'd go back and she'd start at the end. There once was Ophelia, the witch of a... She'd go and fix something. And I was upstairs in my bedroom going, would, witch of a... I couldn't do the next thing until she'd say that. She'd finish it, but she'd go back. Which of the wood a huntsman beheld her alone as she... She coughed and stood. So I think this feeling I've always had, that rhythm is the subconscious. Rhythm is really the key to the subconscious of all of us. Comes from this early part of my upbringing. And it worked really, really well in the Wasteland, which came to New York. Again, we tried not to use a real theater, but used an old porno theater, which was the Liberty Theater on 42nd Street, which had yet to be done up. And it was really strange. There were plastic seats everywhere, and we would only allow 200 people in, even though the seating could allow for maybe 1,000. And these 200 people would sit, and they were allowed in, and somehow the heat of being allowed in rather than going to the theater made people feel they were having a very special invitation. And they were, in a way, because I didn't want to play it more. I believe that poems are to be spoken but not to be shouted. And I think poetry can be theater as long as you keep it intimate. And there was one night, I remember when we first arrived, there's a line in the poem which says, a rat crept softly through the vegetation. And I looked out at the audience, and up the central aisle was a rat listening in. So art and nature became one. But then I've had a few disasters as well. My great friend Dorothy Cross, the artist in Ireland, she invited me to go to the Galapagos. She believes there is no art without nature. So some unwise funding people allowed us to go to the Galapagos. She says that the animals of the Galapagos have reached the highest point of animal evolution, and that we humans, our highest point of evolution is language. So she wanted the language of the high point of human evolution to meet the highest point of animal evolution. So we turned up at the Galapagos Islands with all these iguanas, you know, coming out of the sea, which was amazing, that they can swim and they can walk on land. You think, well, that's good, I can't do that exactly, but I can swim. And there were sea lions who would just, you know, swim up to your mast and kind of mimic you. As you were swimming in the water, they'd mimic you. That seemed astonishing. And there were goats on the island of Isabella who had developed, who had evolved into being able to absorb seawater and not die. They could drink seawater, there was no actual water. And then there were the giant tortoises. So I said, what are we going to do here then? She said, you're going to speak Beckett's Happy Days and see what happens. There is some vault in London, secret video of me with giant tortoises going. Another heavenly day. thing, you know, when they want to deflate, they just go. So that was where, I have to say, language and the highest moment of evolution in animals never met. Nothing happened. But the pleasure of life is finding that some of these things really, really do not work. And it's probably very wise to be humble with them. And then recently, we were less humble. We've been asked by Scott Rudin to come to Broadway immediately with this wonderful book that Colin Tobin wrote called The Testament of Mary, about the Virgin Mary. So, thank you. In fact, I'm about to do it again in London, and I'm very pleased. So all last winter, we spent a lot of time trying to rewrite this piece of writing that Colin had written about the Virgin Mary speaking. Some of you have seen it, but the premise of it is really that the Virgin Mary does not know at all her son's importance. She knows him only as the boy she brought up, found him a little bit arrogant in that he liked sort of practicing elocution and practicing speeches on his friends. She heard that he started to try and make people walk when he shouldn't and was upsetting the Romans, and she gets very nervous about his behavior. So by the time she goes to try and save him from being arrested for his nefarious activities, she really is pretty disillusioned with him, particularly when she sees him wearing beautiful, what are really Renaissance garments, looking rather more like a king than a young man. And when it comes to the crucifixion, she's very upset. Now, this play should have really opened in a synagogue, I think, or in a tiny church. But so sure of the credentials of the writer was Scott that he thought he could go straight on Broadway. But there was one marvelous thing that occurred in this short run on Broadway, which was that Deborah, who'd done a lot of work on installations, she had invented an installation where the Virgin Mary, dressed as the Virgin Mary, me, but with the full blue thing, sat in a glass case whilst a live vulture sat outside on a perch. And there were various things like cigarettes and bottles of whiskey, things that existed in this traumatized woman's life just around the stage. And the audience were invited to view the stage and do anything they liked on the stage. And this is where I became an audience to the audience, because I was sitting holding my lily and my apple, beatified in a glass case. And the audience would go around taking photographs of the vulture. I was terrified of the vulture, who had to be on my arm. But somebody told me, you know, I was sure it was gonna peck my eyes out. But actually, luckily, vultures are only interested in dead flesh. So the key is to stay breathing. The vulture was a disgusting creature, it really was. Anyway, I stayed in my box. But the audience would come in through the backstage, which is also, you know, a really good way of upending people's expectations. Broadway is the cathedral for theatre obsessives. It's the sort of, it's Mecca, but it's also Notre Dame. And so I would sit in my little glass case, overhearing people on the phone going, honey, honey, you never believe where I am. You never believe where I am. I am on Broadway. No, no, I'm on Broadway. I am on Broadway. I'm on the stage, and they're taking pictures. Hang on, honey. And they take a picture of the cigarette butt, you know, or something. And they take a picture of me with the vulture. I'm with a vulture. And in my glass case, people used to come by and watch the Virgin Mary, and I would sit there very still. And sometimes people would go by and they go, she was right, idiot. She showed you. But very often, butch men, two men would come along and go, she's ridiculous. Ridiculous. And then they'd go away, and one of them would come back and go, and then I'd continue sitting, and the audience would fill up, and it did fill up. Of course, it wasn't selling the $400 seats, which is why should it? Nothing should cost $400. But the cheapest seats. In fact, something I met a lady on the bus here going cross town when I was doing the Young Hagen, and she said, "Aren't you the lady from the Testament of Mary?" I said, yes. She said, "I saw it." I said, "Did you? Did you enjoy it?" She said, "Yes. I got in for $5. "Did you?" She said, "Yeah, I'm a member of a group, and when they need to fill houses, we get in for $5. I said, "Did you think it was worth it?" She said, "It was worth twice that." would come by and I'd sit with the Virgin, and then they'd sort of have me a little tear. Adolescent girls often have me a little tear, a little quiet prayer to the Virgin. I wanted to say, it's a play, it's going to begin in a minute. I'm not the Virgin. Stop looking at me like that. And then they'd say things like, I love you. You love me. I'm an actress about to take off this garment and now talk about how I don't believe in my son. And sometimes people came and they knelt. And then I began to think, well, maybe I can get you your exams. What's the point of paying this part if there isn't a bit of a benefit? I began to think, just leave your requests under the desk with a $10 note. You'll find you'll be getting an A in that geography. So that was my experience of finding that in the darkness there was light. I mean, that was a case actually of where the shine of the show did turn to quite serious darkness for me, because there was a 9-foot pool into which I had to plunge when I ran away from the crucifixion. I've given the whole, that was a spoiler. She runs away from the crucifixion. And I would dive into this pool to wash myself clean of this sin. And it was 9 feet or 10 feet deep because there was a tree in there as well. And I'd slide into the pool, go right down and nearly drown, and have to be very careful that the tree didn't in any way upset my parts. And so I'd go right down, come back up. And one night, the stage manager forgot to tell me that they had changed the water. This was March. So I acted away and I plunged down into the pool, and it was ice, pure ice. So I came out of the pool and I knew in that second that every bug in New York said, get her now, get her now. I shivered through the rest of the play. I had to wrap something around me and I just kept on and got to the end of the play and I shivered. And I came off stage and said, who changed the water? Who changed the water? See, and I said, I'm so sorry, I forgot to tell you. I said, fine. Don't worry, tomorrow we heated. So the following day they said, we're heating the water, Fiona, we're heating the water, it's going to be so hot, it's going to be steamy. I said, it doesn't have to be steamy, it just has to be not ice cold. So they heated the water and they said, we'll put some salt in, so it'll be very clean, don't worry. Now, any bugs that didn't exist in cold water began to think, this is nice, this warm water. Why do we stay here? So I plunged into the warm water the following night, came up, felt a bit sick again. This time, Bob had got into my ear. I got an ear infection, second to none. So, as the previews continued, I was warm and was being eaten alive by New York bugs. And by the time we opened, I couldn't hear the audience at all, not at all. I was so swollen in my ear that people must have thought I had a strange affectation. I was doing that all the time. I couldn't hear anybody laugh or cry. And on that night, you know, on the press night, it's so glamorous in New York. People turn up like, I don't know, like Jodie Foster people, they all just turn up, you're in your dressing room. And I thought, at last, I'm meeting Hollywood stars. Hello, hello. And all I got back was, what are you saying to me? I can't hear a word. Not one word. I was very glad, actually, when it closed 2 weeks later that I was able to, well, I wasn't allowed to go home because the doctors wouldn't allow me to fly, but I was able to recover. So sometimes, the shine can come off the thing that's meant to shine. But really, the point I want to make to all of you is that things that begin in darkness can often come into pure Aladdin brightness. And I just want to encourage you to say that if in your co-producing, it encourages you to take more chances, then do. I would say that this title that you've gone for is a dangerous one, because the world out there is very difficult. Theatre has to remake its name. It has to really engage an audience and not charge them $400. $10, I think, is about right. And maybe that's what we all need to work towards. But before I finish, I want to quote a little bit of Seamus Heaney, because at the end of The Cure of Troy, the chorus give these last words, and I read them the other night in Rome, and I just think they may be useful for you too. Now it's the high watermark and flood tide in the heart, and time to go. The sea nymphs in the spray will be the chorus now. What's left to say? Suspect too much sweet talk, but never close your mind. It was a fortunate wind that blew me here. I leave, half ready to believe that a crippled trust might walk, and the half-true rhyme is love. Thank you.
Cinema experience and theater and how different or alike they are for you. As some actors I've spoken to make a big distinction between the theater experience and the film experience, and others find it not that much of a shift.
Well, in my case, you know, if you're from Ireland or Britain and you've got a very sharp nose like this and you speak with a funny accent, it's unlikely that you're going to hold the cultural metronome of the country of America. And so we tend to be cast as either baddies, Harry Potter, or murderers, the Black Dahlia, something mentioned, I'd forgotten that, or silly people like the Three Men and a Lady. So you either play the fool or the clown. In that way, I think America is the empire. And those of us on the edge of the empire come in every now and then and play the oddballs. So, I think my life in film has often been playing the oddballs that nobody else probably in America wants to play. They probably think, who can we get? Who doesn't want to play that? Get that woman over there. she'll do it. So I think my experience of film doesn't hold the same moral pleasures that playing heroines, and I don't mean that in any, you know, but playing somebody who holds the moral center of the evening. I think my life in the theatre has held that, and my life in film has not. But in terms of acting, acting is acting, and it's always hard work, and I prefer the theatre because it's communal in its rehearsing. Though I do an awful lot of things of my own, so it's often not communal. And I'm often very lonely. Happy days sitting in a lump of lead or stone is not very communal. And just done the Ancient Mariner band, and that's not very common. There's one dancer, there's myself just spouting off lots of the Ancient Mariner. But I think it's text, of course, is the great pleasure of the theatre, and in film, it is silence. Film is the great art form of the inarticulate, and that's why it's really important. It elevates silence to poetry. You know, you take someone's face and you blow it up on the screen, and in that moment, everything is understood. And it also, very cleverly, film calls out the lie of language. I think, you know, Shen Shisheng, the Chinese director, told me once that in the Beijing Times, when he was growing up, you'd open the newspaper in the morning and it would say, very sunny day in Beijing, and you'd look out and it was raining. So the Beijing Times would insist it was sunny, and it was in fact raining. And then it would say, any country didn't like America, it would say, raining very hard in Los Angeles. And he said, they began to realize that language was entirely stolen and corrupted, and goodness knows, we know that from politicians. So the status of language has gone up and down, and it's only, I think, in poetry, or in the poetry of theater, that language remains true. And what I admire about film is it is very wary of language. Yes? That table is very bright.
Thank you so much for your talks. This is incredible. Given all of the extraordinary things that are happening in the world today, climate change and immigration and social justice and injustice, are there any particular plays or topics that you wish that someone would be writing right now that you could play?
No, I think, you know, this must be an endless problem for all of you people who are trying to You know what Seamus Healy says? He says, it's not our job to describe the world, it's our job to meet it. And I think that's so true of poetry, but also true of the theatre, is that it doesn't matter whether you decide to mount, you know, a Tennessee Williams play, or a Greek play, or a Shakespeare play, or an anything play, or make up your own play, but it must meet the scale of the problem that we're facing. And you can do that by, I believe all plays can make new theatre. I believe new theatre can make old plays, if you're not careful. So it should never seem like a play. Everything should seem a new event in its own making. And I really think people can take tried and tested texts or new texts, but don't let it be smaller than the problem that we're facing. So I don't particularly have any, I don't hang around looking in the mirror every day going, one day I'll play Cleopatra. No. They might have to get a nose job. Because I'm hoping that by the time we get to do Antony Cleopatra, it will be, the women will be playing Antony and the men will play Cleopatra, whatever, as you have gotten their lovely 12th night down the road here. That it really, maybe we're finally beginning to break through those boundaries of what should be. I was so surprised when Phyllida Lloyd decided to do Julius Caesar. But setting it in a frame, with all women, but setting it in a frame of a prison allowed the very sophisticated modern audience, you know, I'm not sure that play, that show could have happened 30 years ago. People would have gone, oh, I don't know. But somehow we're so used to deconstruction and fragmentation and breaking from text into modern text and back out again that we've finally given ourselves the permission to take these sacred cows of text and throw them in the air, take out their guts, put them back in, do whatever you can, but make the thing live now. And I feel it's a very exciting moment, so I don't have anything in particular, but everything will be the answer.
A moment ago you said, and by the way, thank you so much for The Wasteland. It was a very special invitation. A moment ago you talked about the phrase moral center to do with roles in Hollywood, but I wonder, you've been a very outspoken participant in the conversation about national funding in your own community in particular. Could you apply the word moral center to the arts funding? Where do you see the moral obligation for arts funding right now?
I mean, I was thrilled to hear that you've got a bigger endowment this year than before. But given the size of the country, and given the actual healing power of the theatre, the potential for it, the potential for people to get fed up with digital... I mean, there's something terrifying at the moment about the internet, because that's just still the first act of the internet, is where we are with the first act. And when you look up YouTube, you know, you can look up something like one of those meditations, and somebody will go, "Hi, how are you? It's good to see you." You're not seeing me. You're somebody on the screen saying, "Have you thought about flowers and poetry?" Think you're not talking to me. So the falseness of the person who appears to be appearing in our internet screens will one day sing itself out, and we will need to feel this tonal accuracy of live exchange, and again we'll meet in rooms, and again we'll want to hear the truth only as we test the truth with a real person in front of us. And the theatre by that time must be up to that moment and not be some retrograde old-fashioned thing, you know, to make retired people feel good. But it should also it should invite retired people, by the way, they're also part of the audience, but it must include absolutely everybody. And I think that funding would really allow an audience access to themselves. And that's where the moral centre lies, not because theatre makers should be paid more, and also because you people need to be freed of the belief that you must make the box office answer the achievement. If the achievement is anything, it'll take so many weeks to get good that nothing can be good in 3 weeks. It really cannot. It can be lucky in 3 weeks. You can do well in 3 weeks considering dot, dot, dot. The compromise that you're asking a group of people to invent a world in 3 weeks and to deliver it is an impossibility. And a box office of 300 seats or 400 seats cannot ever supply enough food and jam for those people. So it has, the moral center of it has to be a communal agreement that we all must help the thing that needs help. And it's so true with ballet, so true with singing, so true with opera. These skills cannot exist on a tiny box office table. And something, I know it's partially capitalism, but even the cleverness about American capitalism is that it's often very socialist and very generous. And if only people stopped using the wrong words about it and could stop seeing the word commune as appearing to be, you know, something to do with communism and all its ills, but could see that maybe it's better if we help each other, I think the moral center is very clear. For the future of the theater, but also for the future of the sanity of the country, you need to be funded. Something says 5:53 there. Have I spoken for 5 hours?
So, Ms. Shaw, here in the corner. I'm a huge, huge fan of much of your work. And one of the things, one of the reasons I am such a fan is you seem to have this unbelievable life force, spirit, whatever you want to, what name you want to put on it. So my question to you is, how do you keep that, where do you go to regenerate? Where does this, where do you find your continuing optimism, inspiration, force? Because you are a force of nature for me when I see you in the theater. And I know that's a very large question. It could be just you love peanut butter sandwiches, but but it strikes me every time I see you in the theater, so I have to ask.
Well, I don't know, thank you very much for very nice remarks, but I mean, where I find my respite is in sleep. I absolutely love going to sleep, and I'm exhausted a lot of the time. It's quite hard work being me, you know. It's just, I have my mother's insatiable desire for excitement. That's largely what it is. So most things go back to the drawing more to the, you know, to childhood. But I think my mother's 87 and drives around in a little sports car where she bumps most other cars in Cork. And she gets arrested and then you know, pretends something went very wrong with the car. I think nothing went wrong with the car. Recently she was driving home drunk from somewhere and a policeman stopped her because her lights weren't on and she had no safety belt. And he said, "Madam, you're drunk." She said, "I am." She said, "And I'm completely lost." And he said, "Don't worry, push over and I'll drive you home." That's the country I come from, anarchy, pure anarchy. My brother furious saying, "Arrest her, arrest her." She was arrested. You know, everybody could see that. But inspiration, you know, you're hearing me talk about the events that occurred. There are piles of things bubble up into my mind or with others that come to nothing. I mean, there are lots of ideas. But the excitement for me is that partially I get a bit fed up with getting to the end of things. And I have been very lucky. In my 20s, I played a lot of those Shakespeare heroines at the Royal Shakespeare Company. I played Beatrice and Portia and Rosalind. And, you know, once you got to the end of them, there really wasn't that much left to play unless you bumped into the male area, and that wasn't very welcome, as I discussed earlier. So, you know, maybe being a woman is a good thing in that even though I die of jealousy and envy of my male colleagues, as every television program, you know, has something like, I don't know, we've got another Sherlock Holmes, and I think, why isn't a woman playing Sherlock Holmes? Well, there's many reasons why not, but it just keeps you on your toes to be female, because it is to be what the Greeks felt was the lowest form of human life. Yeah, but they also believed that they were the subjects of tragedy, women, because the gods have been crueler to women than to anyone else. I can't say that's been my experience. So I think it's just trial and error and conversations with interesting people like yourselves.
I don't know about you, but she is the reason I do. She's the part of the reason I do this work. So I just wanted to share that. Before we close, yes. Scott, okay. Can you pull Craig out, please? Anyway, before we close, I just wanted to thank just a couple more people. Suzanne Roach, Alicia Anstead, Carol Miller, our interns, Lindsay Budkus and Katie Andrew, and Parker Burton of our Hilton staff, and our great staff photographer, Gabby Porter. But there's one individual I wanted to highlight and thank publicly here. Many of you know, my partner, husband of 22 years, Craig Hornes, is volunteer for the conference. Having said that, I wish you all Godspeed. This conference is closed.